Napakayaman ng impormasyon ang nabigay ng ating tatlong tagapagsalita. At mapalad tayo na nakinig sa kanila, lalong-lalo na itong mga estudyante natin. Talagang wala, no? Kaalaman tungkol sa bahaging yon ng ating kasaysayan. So sa puntong ito ay malayang magkomentaryo, magtanong ang ating mga estudyante. Hindi ito estudyante, pero mukhang estudyante. Kolig ko ito sa Department ng Kasaysayan. Pakilala ka naman, please.
Hello. Magandang umaga po. Po si Aaron Maliari mula po sa Departamento ng Kasaysayan. So, maraming salamat po sa napakagagandang mga presentasyon ngayong umaga. So, yung tanong ko po, bilang isang batang guro ng departamento, isa talaga sa gusto kong maabot ng talakayan namin sa Kasaysayan 1 ay yung panahon ng batas militar. At isa talaga sa gusto ko rin ay maalala ay, or hindi talaga maalala or mabigyan ng ideya yung mga mag-aaral at maging yung sarili ko na rin ma-remind nung panahon ng batas militar dahil hindi naman namin talaga siya naranasan. Pero yung tanong ko po, nire-recognize natin yung value ng pag-alala doon sa lahat ng atrocities ng batas militar para nga doon sa call natin na never again sa martial law or sa atrocities ng authoritarian government. But my question is, how do we strike a balance between teaching it in such a manner that they would have the consciousness of the period and not necessarily demonizing the Marcos government or Marcos himself? Because I believe that in such a process of tackling the topic in such a manner of almost demonizing them, we're also propagating a particular myth in a sense that they're also being demonized. So, because one semester when I was discussing this period and I was showing a documentary about the period, one of my students really walked out of the classroom because she was an Ilocana and she had a hard time really accepting what she was watching. So we had a consultation together. And as a young member of the faculty, I really had a hard time handling the situation. Because I had a particular bias in mind when I was doing the lecture. I wanted them to know the atrocities of the period. But then, when this student walked out, I really didn't know what to do because here we have a student brought up in a family of loyalists and she already had a particular mindset regarding the martial law period. So my question is, how do we, or what I would like to get from you is your opinion on how do we try to discuss it in such a manner that we're not really, offending sensibilities of other people who might have a different point of view regarding it. How do we not demonize it, but still get the message across of never again? So yeah, thank you po.
And Raisa.
Okay, bawat taon sa aking mga kurso, sa lahat ng aking mga kurso, graduado man or undergrad, pag dumadating na ang September 21, August 21, September 21, yung first quarter storm sa January at sa February 24 to 26, nagpapalabas talaga ako ng ginawa ko. I really spend hours on it, no? Kasi ang swerte ko, I have the voice clips of Pepe Diokno, Ninoy Aquino, Senator Tanyada, Lian Alejandro, kasi gumawa nga ako ng documentary. And I have, although tinanggal, inaano ko yon, hindi ko pino problema yung demonizing. Anong demonizing? Tayo ang dinimonyo. You cannot, as a teacher, not take a stand. The facts are there. Ipakita mo, ipasalita mo sila. You don't even have to interpret it. Kasi kung ipasalita mo sila, and I can give them to you, all my PowerPoints, I can give them to you. They're available for free. Because ang gusto ko lang ay marinig nila yung mga talagang humamon sa batas militar. Marinig nila ang boses ni Monico Atienza na naglalarawan ng paglipat-lipat niya sa mga ano. And they have to be in short clips kasi pag hahabain mo, hindi na makikinig ang estudyante. Kailangan dito siguro mga 30 seconders, at most 1.5. At ang palagi kong piniplay, of course, ay ang musika ng na nilikha nating sa martial law, no? Kasi at hindi ko nga ipakita dito yung mga cartoons. Kasi once I went to the asked the library, no, nasa na yung mga lampoon issues ng collegian. Kasi I remember during martial law, kapag nandyan na yung once every year, naglalabas ang kolehiyo ng lampoon issue. Dapat mabilis ka kasi madaling mawala yon, no? Ay, tinapon namin, ma'am, kasi comics yun eh. Sabi nila, no? Pero maswerte ako na nakukuha ko yung ibang, ano, kasi dito nakikita natin, and then Ibon also has a lot of imaginative graphics. Na nag-i-interpret ng datos. Pero linalagay nila sa... I can show it to you if you want. Pero ang mahalaga dito, let the data speak. You don't even have to comment eh. Kasi pag makita nila yon, at importanteng marinig nila ang mga boses nila, joke, no? Kasi hindi na nila kilala ang mga ito. And maswerte tayo ngayon na we have the technology. You can download so many things from YouTube, no? At yung mga hindi accessible, ano. At I remember na nung pumunta ako sa Santo Niño Shrine nga, I was so amazed na hindi naman yung shrine niya Santo Niño, kundi talagang luho merong... But it was also, you could also see, can you imagine yung ceiling na parang weave yung Nara wood? Tapos, you can, it's really also a testament sa craftsmanship. Yun ang, ano, ni Imelda, no, na nagpadala siya doon ng mga Betis, mga woods, craftsmen from Betis. Marunong siyang pumili ng mga, ano, ewan ko kung saan niyang talent na kuha yun. But she did use a lot of native materials and native craftsmanship at the same time na nagsha-shop siya abroad, no? Ganon. And she did spend lots of time. Ang favorite perfume niya was Joy. So anyway, and I happened to, I saw her several times, but kahit hindi sa'yo kasi nangyari yun, importante totoo na ikwento natin ang ikwento. Ang ikinamamangha ko ay, or ang ikinaiinisan ko ay, bakit kaya walang mga nobela tungkol sa martial law? Dapat, ang dami-dami kasing, for example, I read one, no? Eating Fire, Drinking Drug, Eating Fire, Drinking Water. At I usually read a portion of it to my students. And then I read an excerpt from Closer Than Brothers ni Al McCoy para sa actual, the fiction and the actual. The actual is even more horrible than the fictionalized. Ang sabi nga ni Gabriel Garcia Marquez, it's so easy to be a writer. because mas naka the fiction, the reality is much more horrible than any fiction you can ever write, no? And the thing to do is, and we have this talent for telling a story. Huwag nating tanggalin yon. Telling a story, it must be in children's books, hindi lamang sa grade school, nasa children's book dapat yon. There's a way to do it. The other countries have done it, no? And then, as a teacher, I advise you, I always tell my students that there is no such thing as objectivity, no? The moment you focus on something, you're already interpreting. But, you ipaliwanag mo ang iyong stand, but for the most part, I let the data speak. So, even your PowerPoint presentation, you must know the it must be well done. It must be, kasi video-oriented sila, no? But, me kasi I'm a sound and video editor, so I can do it. But, it must be short lang. It must be powerful. Kasi yung memory mo, it will anchor itself on graphic images, no? Or on words. And then they can talk about it later. There always must be a reflection of what you saw. No matter what their reflection is, no? That is where the participation goes. But don't, whatever subject you are teaching, every year, every semester, you must talk about martial law, whether it's in literary theory sa amin or historiography. Ganyan, because history ay pagsabi ng istorya. Istorya. Paano natin sasabihin ang istorya natin? Yun lang. If you accuse us of demonizing Marcos, he demonized himself. Nobody else helped him do it. He did it himself. We are the myth breakers. Kasi ano nga, ang tawag ko nga sa kanya, salamangkero. He duped us. Diba? He's 27 medals. Who can, I mean, pati yung, on the day that the U.S. military government sent a document saying that the Maharlika group did criminal activities during the war, was the day also that Marcos gave an interview on his war exploits, and unfortunately it was the interview that got more mileage than the document. Let us look at the documents. Again, let the documents speak. And I'm very happy that there will soon be a museum of martial law that is being that is going to be erected.
You know, maybe what you could do is to shock the minds of your students, no? You would need some preparation for this. Before February or September, you could ask, find out who the Marcos, who likes Marcos, the Marcos loyalists, the Marcos lovers, and the anti-Marcos, and then put them into two teams. One team, and give a topic, the human rights record of Marcos, and make the Marcos loyalists take the opposite side. So they have to research, and they will be forced to research and tell them that your grade depends, you know, part of your grade depends on this. So you will have the Marcos loyalists castigating the human rights record of Marcos, and the other side defending the human, and that would be a very interesting thing, you know. And you could just say, if anybody objects, you know, this is not fair, and you say, that's debates are done all the time, and maybe, you know, you should practice it. The second thing is that I do believe, as Dr. Maceda said, let the documents speak for themselves, you know. One, if you have a loyalist in your class, you could even ask that loyalist to voice out why the family is so loyal. I always believe in finding out the perspectives of as many sides, no? That's why I take the time out. I go out of my way to interview the Marcoses. I've interviewed Imelda Marcos and Bongbong Marcos. It's good that you get all perspectives. And that's what history is about. You have to find out what the point of view is of all the sides.
My student, Mr. Gonzalez. I'm sorry. Before your question, Frank Simato would like to say something too.
Okay na. Kami naman, I'm talking about the Marcos babies, ano. Ang national language kasi namin is irony and sarcasm. Ang aking education kasi about the Marcos, hindi naman siya nababasa ko kasi wala akong nababasa eh. It's reading Jingle Magazine. Yung joke page, may kwantun eh. Hindi tacit yung paglalaban, pero nang doon, sa panunood ng Mike De Leon, hindi kay Lino Broca eh. Kay Mike De Leon, ako natuto yung sa class 81. So, oblique lahat, tangential yung, sinabi nga ni Fenton na ang mga Marcos babies, may mata sa likod eh. Iba yung tingin namin, pop culture namin kinukuha. Yung galit namin kay Marcos, nag-overflow when binanya ang Botes 5. We saw doon yung Bosnian Empire, yung Marcos. So, ganun yung education namin, it's pop culture. Doon kami lumaban, kasi doon kami sinira.
Okay. Mr. Gonzalez.
So, Mr. Gomez.
I called you. Sorry.
So, but before I give my question, I'd like to give a little introduction. I was born in 1996, but I was still a baby then, so I don't have any consciousness. So my consciousness maybe came around 2005, so that's the perspective I'm talking about. The growing sentiment among people in my generation, or at least the people I see on my newsfeed who share pro-Marcos posts, pro-Marcos posts, they're all like, Marcos, greatest president, greatest achievements, list of all his achievements, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's a growing sentiment. And when you share a picture on Facebook, you have this option of share your thoughts. And the thoughts that they write are, yung mga matatanda that grew up during the Marcos era, they forgot all the good that Marcos did because it was covered, it was overshadowed by all the bad that he did. So that is a growing sentiment I see on my Facebook newsfeed. So is that true that the people who lived in the Marcos martial law era, did they really forget all the good that he did because of all the bad that he did? Is Marcos not the greatest president? And great does not have to mean positive. Great can also go both ways. Could he be the greatest in terms of achievement? Is he really the greatest in terms of crime? My consciousness started, let's say, 2005. I did not witness the events firsthand. And I think that was Professor Robles who said that a lot of these controversies were not made to the public until after the martial law itself. So even the people who lived through martial law did not experience these firsthand. They did experience some stuff, especially if some relatives went missing. But a lot of these controversies only came out after. So how do we know that a lot of these anti-Marcos propaganda is not made by his enemies? How do we know that a lot of this anti-Marcos was made by his political enemies to try to get his assets away and to make sure that his posterity does not get voted like Bongbong Marcos? Because it's already a given fact that pro-Marcos sentiment is, you know, propagated by Marcos loyalists. But what about the anti-Marcos sentiment? How true is that? That's all.
Okay, Raisa?
You have a very good point, though. One of the problems was that a lot of the documentation of the Marcos crimes were in the hands of the military. And it is only when Walter Gasmin became defense secretary that he started releasing the documents on the torture, you know, on the Marcos victims. So we need a lot of documentation to come out. You want proof that it doesn't come out from people who are biased. I think that's what you're saying. Well, the proof is all in paper, on paper, and that paper, all those documents have been sealed. I talked to Human Rights Commission Chairman Loretta Ann Rosales about these documents. He said that it's really, really voluminous. But they are going to try to put it online as well as put together a room where you can actually go and look. Now, as to the, how do we know that we're not demonizing? I think you would base it on the credibility of the person speaking. And you also do have evidence already. Like, for instance, the assassination of Ninoy Aquino, that is very well documented. How can a person in a high security area suddenly get shot while being escorted by authorities? I mean, you have to ask yourself, and you cannot, I mean, the only conclusion you can make in your mind was that he was shot with a purpose, And if you're saying, is there anything good that the Marcoses did? You have to look at the entire thing. It's true that the good things that they did, like the cultural center, the different hospitals, in a way they're good because they're being used, they were really overrun by the monumental bad things that they did. Is Marcos the greatest president? Greatest in English has a very positive connotation. So you cannot say he's a great, great thief, but you could say it satirically. What Marcos has done, actually, I've been thinking about this for some time now. There are two revolutions that have taken place in our country, 1898-1986. The first revolution that we had was against a colonial master. The second revolution we had was against a local despot. In both these revolutions, we served as inspirations to other people in Southeast Asia. In the first revolution we had in 1898, we also inspired them to rise against their colonial masters. In the second revolution we had in 1986, we again inspired them to rise against their local despots. Maybe the thing that Marcos did for the country is we realized that we can overthrow someone who did very bad things to our country. But now, we are realizing at this point that it's not enough to overthrow. This is a continuing revolution and it is not yet finished. Think Janet Lim Napoles, think Juan Ponce Enrile. These are the things that we still have to fight against.
You want to make a rejoinder?
Yeah, konti lamang. Na siguro ang para sagutin ka, military brat ako, you know. Kaya first hand ko nakita, ang father ko was the dean of the Philippine Military Academy from 1965 to 1974. So, ang mami ko ay tuwing dadating si Imelda, she had to go and, you know, play host, no? So, and yet, in every family, may split yan eh. When it came to taking positions, we took different positions and mag-aaway ang mga klan, no? But as to the, I know personally sila, we grew up together with sila Gringo, etc. They were always in our house, but they also served as torturers. They were Juan Ponce Enriquez boys, no? But they were very close to my father. What you have to do really is to ask yourself. I know that you say that you were not participant. How do we know that your memories are true? Memories will not lie when anchored in actual experiences. No? You can, of course, over time, this is my own experience growing old, my memories of the past get sharper. I can remember minute details, but my memory of yesterday is blurred. I mean, it gets sharper, and it's not that. And you tend to be more reflective, okay? So what will you do with this? I think there is so much documentation already that has happened. If you read A Vision, A Nation for Our Children by Pepe Diokno, he is one lawyer, senator, who really, in his speeches, does a lot of research, no? So, yung task force detainees, they documented that. All the, you go to Ibon Data Bank. You go to, those were our, first. And then the School of Economics before used to come out with white papers, no? So, kasi, hindi nga reliable ang news. Ang mas reliable pa nga ay yung mga kind of investigative journalism that goes on even in campus papers like the Collegian, although I haven't read much of the Collegian recently. But if they were, for example, there was those Plampun issues, when you're able to laugh at what is happening, that's when you know that you're getting power. Like, for example, the People's Journal became the People's Urinal. You know, yung mga ganun na, P.S. I love you became P.S. I love you. Tapos, Evitay, for Evita, no? And then it's news around ma. When Lampun is, hindi ka pwedeng magbiro na walang katotohanan somewhere, no? And when you are able to laugh at it, that's when you are able to ridicule the powers that be. You cannot call Marcos great. Was he a great president? No, he was not. Because if you look at the other countries, nakasabay natin na mas maangat tayo ngayon, noon, kulelat na tayo ngayon. And my own frustration is, why in heaven's name did he not build a good airport during his time? Bakit tayo ang pinaka-worst airport in the world, no? Despite the edifice complex of Imelda, our international airport is shut, no? So, there are enough people, and remember that even before this phase, there was a never again site. There still is. I don't know who visits it, but there are a lot of recountings, no? Maganda nga sa South Africa ang nangyari sa Truth Commission na pinagharap yung torturer at yung victim. But that in itself was so traumatic, and eventually it was the lawyers talking for the victims who which defeated the purpose. Yun.
The gentleman in white, please introduce yourself.
Magandang umaga po sa tanghali na po pala. Dito rin po ako, sugentering po ako sa UP Asian Center. But in any case po, I will not argue dun sa mga pinresent nyo because there's truth in it. Sabi nga po sa history, there's no objectivity in history. Diba nga po? And I'm reiterating your own words, ma'am, or paraphrasing it. At the same time, ma'am, sinasabi rin po kasi natin na the antidote for ignorance is not reading less, but reading more. While I agree with some of the, how do I say this, of the facts presented by Ms. Robles, I think the reason why people are having positive thoughts for the Marcoses is because there are alternative literature na lumalabas. When I was younger, puro anti-Marcoses eh. And then suddenly, during the 90s when I was studying here in UP, parang ang dami. Well, why is it inconsistent? So, in this way, ma'am, I will disagree with you. As a teacher, I was also a teacher in UP Manila. I will not take a stand because it will curtail the critical thinking of the student. Give them all the information. Let them think for themselves. Para at least alam nilang ginagawa nila. Ako ma'am, masasabi ko para sa aking sarili. Why is it that people in this country, the younger generation, have positive thoughts? Siguro dahil wala pa tayong resolution about the Marcos era eh. We don't have this scholar na, Truth Commission nga po na sinasabi nyo, a scholar na talaga nagdi-debate about the happiness eh. Kasi ako, nakita ko, nung panahon ni Cory Aquino, 18 to 22 hours of brownout. Nagutom kami. Unlike nung panahon nung ni Marcos, I was really ano, and I was running young then. Busog kami. May nakakain kami, may trabaho ang nanay ko, may trabaho ang tatay ko. And then suddenly, all of the sudden, and this is what we are experiencing. So ma'am, I think, as a wrap up, I think the reason kung bakit nagkakaroon ng positive perspective, one of the reasons about the Marcoses is because may bagong information eh. And we didn't highlight it during our times eh. So, nakikita namin eh. And we believe, oh, ito to. Image can be very strong. Ito siya eh. Oh, bakit hindi ako maniniwala? Unless, sinasabi nyo nga, oh, may mga museum that. But the question is, since there is no objectivity in history, it is not what happened. It is why it happened. All along, sabi nga nila, it has the blessing of the Congress. In 1986, Marcos won that election. And tapos sabi nila, pinaalis nila, the Russians declared it's a revolution, not a revolution, but a mob rule. So you have to, from UP, you have to pagsama-samahin nyo po and then have this particular libro na this is what we think, this is our stand. Para at least magkaroon kami ma'am ng definite perspective. Hindi yung parang iba-iba po. Yun lang po, thank you.
Anyone of the speakers would like to respond, Raisa and then Frank?
In other words, you want an extension of the history of the Filipino people which has not been updated since 1972? I wish that UP scholars would, you know, would spearhead this. We need an honest-to-goodness history book. We need two kinds of history books, actually. One for yung teenagers, tsaka college graduates, and another one for children. We need that badly, Dr. Rico Jose.
Frank?
I mean, naman, when we started with Roland dun sa Mondo Marcos, it took us mga 8 years to finally bring it out. Kasi nung una, puro antay yung nakuha namin. Sabi ko, pati mga bata na, sabi ko, talaga ba na-experience nyo to? And then, I had to wait and then write to other people until I got may pagka-pop culture na lumabas na may konting may mga parents nila, mga loyalist, until I got a better society, a better societal na sweep, ano. So, tama yung sinabi nung nag-question kanina, kasi ang balak namin, yung marami, we should talk about Marcos. Kasi it took us like 20 years, it's a generation, ano. And then wala ka man lang Marcos conference, di ba? Pero meron tungkol sa kamote. Bakit walang Marcos? Eh, 20 years yun eh. It's one generation na parang pinabayaan natin. And then, pati si GMA, ginagawa na niyang model, wala tayong masabi. Well, we should be talking about it.
In conferences, no? Sinabi mong tutol ka sa sinabi ko na kailangan mag-make ng stand, no? All theorists make stands. But we also allow different perspectives. Hindi pwede yung sa isang klase, pare-pareho na lang kayong, ano, someone has to challenge, no? And it's very good when people feel free to challenge the teacher even, no? It makes for better, ano. Now, with regards to having to, you know, provide this generation, the sad thing about martial, the post-martial law, is it seems to be na ayaw ng mga dumanas ng martial law na kumprontahin siya agad, no? We probably, even in history, kailangan mo ng a little distance. Ang problema talaga ay yung politics of accommodation that came in, no? Maski na nga nung panahon ng Ninoy, no? Yung justice for Ninoy, justice for all. It was sometimes, ano eh, dapat meron kang pag mag-apologize yung kabila, okay na. Hindi pwedeng okay eh. Kailangan may accounting pa rin sa nangyari. Yung accounting na yon, yung ang dapat naging problema, yun ang problema ang dapat harapin ng bayan, at ang accounting ay dapat transparent sa mga tao. Kunwari yung PCGG, if we saw those huge bottles, I also saw those huge bottles of perfume, alam ko may mga ladies na pumapumasok kasi open na open yan, ano? At meron silang sarili nilang bote at kumuha doon eh. Who accounts for all of that? Kasi those are people's treasures also, no? I was one of those who audited the PC, Presidential Center for Strategic Studies, no? And ang daming mga documents doon na voluminous talaga that will take, kasi maraming task forces ang create, no? After that. So, what to do with these things? When ang problema, after martial law, wala ka rin mga taong skilled enough to do the material auditing of many things and documenting properly, kasi expertise yan eh. Hindi pwedeng basta-basta, no? And seeing to it na walang na ano. And ang surprising is that you come across names. Yun ang ang problema. You come across names na alam mong nasa kaliwa and they're working for Marcos, no? And then you don't want to divulge it. There is that moral dilemma that some of the investigators face, no? But it has to be what is there should come out, and what is there should be transparently shown to the people. Yun lang ang ano ko. And if there is something that will substantiate a myth, or if there were things na tinago ni Marcos para pumogi siya, kailangan lumabas yun. Lumabas naman yun eh. Yun lang tinabunan eh. Di ba? So we have to keep digging. At ang siguro ang mga problema ng mga scholars ay hindi natatapos. Ang problema natin ay paano natin ito ikwikwento sa ating, sa mga future generations. Sa isang paraan na mauunawaan at na isa sa konteksto ang mga bagay-bagay.
May tanong pa po. Yun, the young lady at the back, I'm recognizing you, yes.
Ako ba si Erica from the class of Sir Maliari. Tapos, taga-Batak po ako. Taga-Batak po ako. Tapos, lumaki po ako doon and nag-high school ako sa Mariano Marcos State University. So, napalaki po ako doon sa environment na parang pro-Marcos. Father ko po, I think Marcos baby po siya kasi 1964 po siya pinanganak. And then, ngayon po parang, ang tanong ko po kasi every time na birthday ni Marcos, may something sa Batak. Nagpupunta lahat ng mga tao mula sa iba't ibang bayan. Andiyan nagtitipon-tipon, rinirequire mga estudyante na magpunta doon para mag-participate, kantahan si Marcos ng happy birthday. Kulang na lang may yuliv lang pero patay na siya, ganun. Diba po? Ang tanong ko po, kasi yung ano po, ang daming tao, diba? Ang daming tao. Saka sa iba-ibang lugar po siya. And mapapansin mo po sa mga grupo ng taong yun, karamihan din matatanda. Eh, kung na-experience po sana nila talaga kung gaano karahas yung ano, yung pag-rule ni Marcos, paano po nila natitake na mag-ipagbunyi pa si Marcos nang gano'n na bumabiyahe sila ng I don't know kung ilang oras yung biyahe nila mula sa lugar nila para lang sa birthday na yon. Gumagastos sila para sa organisasyon nila or hindi ko rin alam kung may pumupondo doon ng mga t-shirt nila, ng banner nila, ng mga magagarbong sasakyan para lang makapunta doon. So yun po, paano po nila kayang gawin yon? Well, in fact, nandun sila sa era na yon na may nagawa talaga si Marcos. And then, secondly po, ito nga po, lumaki po ako doon. Tapos, iniisip ko po, yung father ko, sabi niya sa akin, ay, ganito kasi yan, maganda rin naman noon eh. Ganito yung, hindi pa private yung karamihan sa mga establishment. Ay, hindi ko po alam kung totoo. Kasi po, syempre, sa Ilocos kami, hindi ko po sure kung talaga lang na kinakat nila yung part na yun ng history. Pero, hindi po talaga siya nai-introduce sa amin ng ganong kalaki. And then, sabi naman ng papa ko, pero nung nag-a-apply na ako ng trabaho after nung ano ni Marcos, hindi na ako naka-apply kasi taga-Norte ako. Ganun. So, nakaka-confuse po siya. Para sa isang bata na lumaki doon, nagpunta dito sa forum na to, hindi mo alam kung saan ka tatayo eh. Pero gusto mo rin isipin, ano ba yung pwede kong mapag-aralan dyan? Or ano pa yung pwede kong i-derive na lesson from that thing? So, ayun po, nakaka-confuse. Thank you.
Okay. At totoo naman na may Marcos loyalists eh. At marami sila. Sinabi nga ni Frank, no? Lalo na sa Ilocos, no? You will find them sa Ilocos, sa Tacloban, Samar, ganon. That's the Imelda country, no? And hanggang Cagayan, all the, ano noon. At, gumanda ang Ilocos nung panahon ni Marcos. Ang Cebu na pinanggalingan ko, ang left to the, ano, kasi walang development at all. Dahil nagre-resist sila, no? So, maraming mga nabiyayaan sa panahon ni Marcos, yun lang nga, yun ang problema kung ang napapaboran ay mga grupo-grupo lamang or mga specific regions at hindi napupunta sa lahat. Okay? At may ginawa yung paano ikaw na lumalaki ngayon sa one, talaga ikot, unawain mo, bakit kaya? Anong mistake ni Marcos? No? Unawain mo siya at mag-reflect ka doon. Minsan rin may pamangkin ako na, meron akong estudyante na ang pangalan talaga ay Marcos at ano. Right after the EDSA revolution, when we were asked to work in Channel 13, that whole TV station was full of loyalists. No? At naging kaibigan ko sila, no? Yung production manager was a cousin of Marcos. At sabi niya, alam mo, ang problema sa inyong mga pumunta dito, sa inyong mga dilaw, na nakadilaw, bakit lagi kayo nag-aaway? Sa panahon namin, isa lang ang nagkakaisa kami para i-project ang iisa lamang. That is because may iba't ibang perspective na pumapasok at nagbabanggaan at hindi sanay ang mga tao doon. Di ba? That's one thing with democracy, no? Kailangan may espasyo sa iba't ibang, sa paglalaban, pagtatagisan ng mga bagay-bagay. Kung nakakain kayo sa panahon ni Marcos, mas konti pa ang mga Pilipino noon. Ngayon, of course, we have to also criticize the current governments that after that. We were also critical of Cory. No? But one thing that Cory remained for us was, ewan ko kung bakit squeaky clean siya until she died, no? She was, her image was that, no? And so many, hindi mo naman mapipilit ang mga taong pumunta. Hindi mo mapipilit ang mga taong bumisita kay Marcos para mag-happy birthday. Kung nasa loob nila na may pagmamahal pa rin sila sa kanilang apo. Pero hindi mo rin mapipilit ang iba na tulad ko na ayaw siyang ipalibing sa libingan ng mga bayani at kung mangyayari yon ay huhukayin ko ang remains ng aking ama at ililipat ko ng sementeryo.
Okay, may tanong pa, komentaryo? Yes, Raisa.
You know, the fact that you told us that shows that there is an awakening in you. And just embrace that and find out more. I know that your mind and your heart will become very convoluted and very troubled because of that. But there was one thing really that Marcos did, you know. He only brought, as Dr. Maceda said, development to Ilocos. And also Leyte because of Imelda. But what we need is development for the entire country. I also wish to say something about what the previous commenter said, no? Kasi there's always this argument on the internet. Mas maganda ang buhay noong panahon ni Marcos. Ngayon, you know, magiging kulang yung kuryente, mataas ang mga bilihin, walang trabaho. You know, those arguments are, in their face, are valid. That life is better. Life seemed to be better during the Marcos dictatorship for as long as you were not picked up and tortured. But, you see, 1986, we have to keep this in mind. 1986 was an unfinished revolution. If you want to have an idea of what it might, you know, what our country looked like then in the early years after martial law, think of what's happening in Egypt. Tahrir Square, you know, the Egyptians were so happy to topple their dictator, and then suddenly now they have bloodshed. That was what happened to us during the coup d'etat. So we could either take the short view that 1986 EDSA failed, or we could take the long view that we do not know yet where it is going, we do not know yet its conclusion, and in fact, I do believe that Facebook and internet, that is where the revolution is now occurring. And it's up to us, you know, to decide where our country is going. You know, corruption, that has been the problem for our country since before the Republic was born. And it is only now that we are making our government officials accountable. You've heard about Manuel Quezon, no? That he said, I want a country, it is better for a country to be run by Filipinos and it's corrupt. But, you know, Manuel Quezon was one of the most corrupt presidents we ever had. He had the mistress and he built the bridge so that he could go from Malacanang to visit his mistress across the bridge. If that happened today, what do you think the scandal would be? You know, I confirmed that fact from Manolo Quezon. I asked him a lot about Manuel, his grandfather Manuel Quezon. So you see, there has been some progress, but we need more progress. That's it.
Hey, may tanong pa. Siguro huli na ito dahil alas 12 na, ha? Scholar. Pakilala ka pa, please.
Hi, good afternoon po. I'm Rage Room MC, also from the class ni Sir Malyari. And, brief background lang po, kasi my mother was Ilocano. So, she raised me up. And she was also raised here, so she raised me up with an idea of having a neutral view with Marcos. Now, he was good, but he was also bad. And I guess that was an anchor for me to see the other governments lowering down, because I lifted Marcos up a little for me. And I know this is a forum about Marcos, but I just wanted to hear your opinion on this with the martial law and with everything that Marcos did, we, like Sir Malyari said, we tend to demonize his government. But my opinion is that maybe we demonize so much the government of Marcos that we tend to lift up the other governments. Now, in your opinion, is that the same thing that's happening right now? That we raise up the other governments, the government of Cory Aquino and the succeeding presidents, because we let down, we put down Marcos. Is it because we lift them up that we are able to maintain the infamy of the Marcos government? Yun lang po.
Nasabi ko na na hindi natin dinidemonize si Marcos, kundi we're letting the documents speak for themselves. I think as citizens of this country, kailangan maging critical tayo sa bawat gobyerno, no? At kailangan aktibo tayo doon. Ang pinakamahirap sa isang revolusyon ay ang after the revolution, ang rebuilding. Mas mahirap yon kaysa sa aktual na revolusyon. Maraming, yung palagi ang failure natin ay yung ating politics of accommodation, no? Collaborationist tendencies and balimbing, etc. At napakagaling ng Pilipinong bumalimbing talaga, no? And we our senses have to be sharp. Or it was a very difficult position for us, because for all of us, dahil sa ating isip, martial law. Tapos biglang kasama natin ang militar sa pagpatalsik sa gobyernong Marcos. How do you
these people are, how can they did not undergo debriefing afterwards or therapy afterwards. A lot of people should have done that. The military should have done that. And now we have this, kunwari, if you read the Alston report, akala mo nagbabasa ka ng documents ng martial law eh. Kasi yung mga extrajudicial killings. In other words, maaring nagbago overnight ang gobyerno, pero naroon pa rin ang kultura. Yun ang mga labi ng kulturang yan, ang mahirap tanggalin at kailangan hamon sa ating mga estudyante at teachers at writers, etc., ang pagtulong para matanggal yung mga hindi kanais-nais sa ating bansa at magkaroon tayo ng political will, no, na tawaging maitim kung maitim at maputi kung maputi, pero sa totoong buhay mas marami ang gray, no, ang hirap. But you have to be transparent in all of this.
Frank?
Okay, yung dalawang Ilocano, ano, ako naman, anak ni Batak, my mother is from Batak, so, yung mga, sa bahay namin doon, may, ang daming libro ni Harzel Spence, ito yung propagandist niya, libre lahat yon. Ang daming mga, binibigay ni Marcos sa bawat bahay sa Batak, so, wala akong question doon, pag nag-debate kami ng mga pinsan ko, hindi ko na sinasagot eh, kasi talo, ang pag-asa ko na yung mga batang kagaya mo na, can think of your old. Nandito si Chia saka si Diane, mga anak din niya ng mga Ilocano, mga loyalist din yung mga parents, pero we were able to think of our own. Ganyan mga kwan eh, yung mga loyalist kasi, in-exploit din ni Marcos yan eh. Kaya ang sinabi ni Belinda Aquino, yung shared Ilocano experience sa Hawaii, Marcos was able to treat Hawaii as a province, as a Ilocano province. So, kahit paano, nung nag-exile siya doon, parang Ilocos lang eh. So, no problem with that. Hindi ko na maintindihan ngayon sa Batak. Yung mga Ilocano na loyalist, na, kagaya ng mga parents ko, they always blame Imelda for the fall of Marcos. Pero ngayon, bakit siya naging congresswoman, kaya doon ako nababagabag na para nag-iba na naman yung mga utak ng mga loyalista. At ngayon, nag-Facebook na sila, so they're getting dangerous. Alam mo yung mga Ilocano, nomadic yan.
Right, sir?
You know, the use of the word demonize, that's what the word that is always used by the Marcos lovers, especially on Facebook. So perhaps, parang what's happening is those who want to argue with them fall into the trap of parang getting into their world. Eh. And so maybe, I mean, yung mga trolls, no, including Marcos trolls, you just have to treat them differently, eh. You know. And Marcos loyalists, they really love Marcos with a visceral sense of love, and so you, some of them really you cannot change. But there are a lot of Filipinos of the new generation. They are the ones who are confused about all this, and that's why it's very important to have an honest to goodness history book that will explain this.
It's a challenge talaga sa historians na magsulat talaga ng isang bagong kasaysayan, no?
If you care to read, I was able to interview extensively Dr. Ricardo Jose on the Marcos medals, and I placed it on my site, raisarobles.com. Dr. Rico Jose has been a historian before he came to the to UP, and he has done extensive interviews, parang first person interviews of major participants in the Second World War. So he was able to tell me a lot about the Marcos medals. I've also put there my own interviews on the Marcos on the Marcos wealth in my parang use the search box Marcos, and all the articles on the Marcoses will come out. I try to keep an open mind, no? I have asked repeatedly a person-to-person interview with Imelda Marcos, but she has never granted me an interview. I've only been able to ambush interview her.